Amen. How many of y'all want to be ready when he comes? See, he's coming back sooner than we think. Amen. So we have to be ready at this time. Do we have any first-time visitors here today? If you would, please stand. Amen. Amen. We thank you, ma'am. Remain standing. We thank you, ma'am, for coming out to worship with us today. We hope something is said or done that will be effective to your life and get you closer to Christ. Amen. We don't take it lightly when we got guests in here. Amen. We thank God. At this time, if you would, I would like for everybody to stand up, go and hug two or three people, and show them some love. Amen. Amen. Keep it right there. Be so also ready. School supplies. Amen. We want to invest in their success in their endeavor in school. So please, when you're going out, not only do you buy tickets from the pastor, but pick up a supply list so you can make donations to see that we have those children blessed. Be blessed. Amen. Amen. It's giving time, church. I'm going to say that again. Y'all ain't learned yet. It's giving time, church. Amen. Now, I want you all to get your best gift out. We already know that there's 10% of giving that God has given to us. If he bless you, ought to be a blessing back. Amen. If y'all would look to y'all right, my left, it is a chart of what we are in our homecoming. Y'all look at that real close. Squint your eyes so you can look real. If you got glasses, pick your glasses up so you can see real good. If everybody would tell me, how much money do we have? I can say not enough, but I want to hear what the amount is. How much do we have? That ain't $3,000, Brother Tony. That's $2,000. That ain't good, church. And I cannot get to the goal unless we get to $30,000. And a matter of fact, I would like $40,000. But I mean, if y'all want to be generous to help me meet the goal, that would be nice. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, we need you. Come on, y'all, help me. Say, neighbor, we need you. So y'all understand that the individual taxation is $150. All auxiliaries are charged with $500. And we can do it together. Amen. Amen. So y'all keep in mind that the deacons are coming as we get ready for the offering. There's a couple of ways of giving here at St. Luke Church. You can give by your cash, or you can give by car. Sister Ms. Prather will be coming to the vestibule to take your credit card, or you can go by Givenify. Search St. Luke Primitive Baptist Church. There you see my face smiling, ready to see whatever you have. Amen. Everybody standing. Lift your gifts high in the air as we state our tithe and promise. Everybody standing. All together, everybody lift your arms. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall be given to your bosom. For with the same measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. I see you. Church, I want y'all to prepare. We have our senior praise dancers coming. Y'all give a hand to our senior praise dancers as they're coming out. While we wait on them, all children, y'all can report to Children's Church. Y'all give them another hand.
someone to compare to your grace, your love, your mercy. Nobody greater than you. Searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater, no. Nobody greater than you. Searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater than you. Nobody can heal like you can. Oh, most holy one, you are the great I am. Awesome in all your ways, and mighty is your hand. You are he who carried out redemption's plan.
Thank you. morning. The Lord's been good to you. Stand on your feet and give us some praise.
You're not.
Say thank you. God, in fact, if you don't do nothing else, you already done enough. God, we thank you. God, we thank you for grace, and God, we thank you for mercy. And we lift your name on high. So God, I ask that if there's any demonic spirit in the place, I ask that you send it back to the pits of hell from which it came. If there's any burden right now, God, that's too hard to carry, God, I ask that you help share the load with us today. God, if there's any teary eyed of sorrow, God, I ask that you convert those tears back to joy in the name of Jesus. God, you said that there's two or three gathered in your name, you'll be there. God, I ask that now you come into this place, fill this place with your Holy Spirit, that lives won't leave the same way they came. In Jesus' name. Now, God, I ask in this preaching moment, you increase and I decrease. If they see you and not me, they see my heart and not my mouth. God, I ask that you give me the gifts of biblical preaching, that your people don't be both be receptive and the responsive to the preaching of your word. In the name of Jesus that I pray. Amen. Come on, y'all, give y'all choir a hand, please. Amen. Give these musicians a hand. Doing a marvelous job. Y'all are doing a little bit better than that. There y'all. Come on. Doing a marvelous, marvelous job. Marvelous job. Church, we are going to conclude our Sticking to the Mission series. hopefully this has encouraged you to get to know the mission here at St. Luke. Y'all be stuttering when it's time to say the mission statement. And that's all right. Last Sunday, Elder Core came, preached the story of Lazarus. He did a marvelous, marvelous job. Amen. I want to bring some of y'all's attention, just as your pastor, something you ought to be careful with when we do communion and foot washing service, that because of you, most of you all don't know the culture of Primitive Baptist, and that's fine. I didn't know until I came to Nashville myself. I understand that, but you miss out on communion forsaking foot washing. I'm gonna say that again. It bothers me. It boils my blood when we all get up and y'all more together walking out than y'all are coming in. Y'all can say amen. Elder Core say, am I right about it? Y'all get up and go, but you forsake communion. But the bread was his body, and the cup was his blood for your sin. You running from somebody's feet, but you need to be running to the table and you're saving somebody's life. Amen. Amen. Now I know your neighbor's foot might be, never mind. No, but seriously, listen to me real good. Next time, listen to the chairman. When he stands, he sets the house in order. And he says that if you are to in need, women, to if it's any garments that you, extra garments that will prevent foot washing, you go and you do otherwise. And you feel unworthy, scripture says, of the cup, you don't take. But when communion and foot washer, once you've taken your communion, all you have to do is sit and observe. We don't make you wash somebody else's feet. But as your pastor, the spiritual symbolism of communion, if worthy, needs to be taken for the remembrance of what he did at Calvary. Y'all are Baptists, right? Y'all believe in Christ, right? Am I in the right house? Amen, somebody. Y'all stay and take communion. Understood? Amen. Amen. I really appreciate it. Now it's time for preaching. The book of Jonah, first chapter. Y'all forgive me. I get whooped when y'all don't do right. Amen. So y'all gonna frown all you want to. Don't hide your amens. Deacon Berkeley, can I have three more amens from you today? Amen, amen. Let's stand. The book of Jonah, church. We gonna scatter around. Y'all bear with me. The book of Jonah. When you found that shout. I said when you found that shout. The very first verse says these words. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh, preach against it. Because wickedness has come before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed to Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for the port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed to Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Y'all go down to verse 7. Verse 7 says these words, then the sailors said to each other, come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity. They cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. So they asked him, tell us who is responsible for making all the trouble for us. What do you do? Where do you come from? And what country? From what people are you? He answered and said, I am a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who has made sea and land. This terrified them, and they asked, what have you done? They knew he was running away from the Lord because he had already told them so. Go down to verse 15. Watch this, church. Verse 15 simply says, then they took Jonah and threw him overboard. And the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. But the Lord provided a great fish, swallowed Jonah. Jonah was inside of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Two great transitions. The first butt was from man, and the last butt was from the Lord. Hear it as we go into our sermon scripture. But Jonah ran away from the Lord. And then verse 17 says, but God, but the Lord provided a great fish. Usher, you may be redeeming your charge of service. Thank you for standing boldly. I want to preach as a conclusion to our sermon series, Sticking to the Mission. Stuck somewhere between good and not so good. Stuck between good and not so good. Church, I think the hardest part for me as a pastor, preacher, or even a servant of God is to be given a mission or a purpose that's not comfortable. The hardest part is preaching in front of people who really don't like you. Since I'm there, I might as well pause and say, if y'all didn't already realize, this day last year, I was called to Pastor St.Luke. Today. And the next day, I had to preach to those who didn't vote for me. Amen. If it's you, don't touch nobody. Just look down. Amen. Amen. The hardest part about serving with purpose with God, church, is that God directs us to love those who don't love us. And to give to those who wouldn't normally give to you. And then have enough gall to tell us sometimes we gotta be lonely. The hardest part about serving God, church, is it's not popular, nor is it famous. You don't get likes for it. Nobody shares your status with Christ. Nobody seemingly wants you to come over. You are always the oddball, and God puts you directly in the middle because it is your oddness and it's the people not liking you that bring souls back to Christ. That the very thing that pleases God, we turn around and hate. I remember church in Huntsville, Alabama. We went to a family reunion. And my dad, being one of the oldest tenure pastors in our family, hadn't showed up yet. But I was outside with the men. They were cooking and they were drinking. Amen. They were cooking, they were drinking, and they were talking about God knows what from A all the way to Z. I remember it very well. And I remember specifically because I remember my dad's car pulled up. And everybody stopped what they were doing, stopped talking. Every man went over, put on a clean shirt. Every man stopped talking about the women they had done. I'm being real about it. Everybody took the beer bottle and went and got a red Solo cup. Don't act new with me today. And they poured their drink in their cup. They folded their legs up, sat up in their chair. And when my dad walked up, everybody said, hey, Pastor, how you doing? My dad went in the house and I asked the question, deacons. I said, now, why y'all do all of that? My dad's cool. And they told me, listen, wicked people told me this. They said, when man of God show up, you act right. Now, I'm not saying that for y'all to respect me, but if your life has not gotten to the point where people get uncomfortable when you come around and stop their wrongdoing right, then maybe you still in the wrong. And if you don't make people uncomfortable and compromise with their wrongdoing, we have yet to miss the mark that God have us to be. It's uncomfortable to serve the Lord. It's uncomfortable to serve the Lord. Not only is it uncomfortable to serve the Lord, but watch this, church. Not only is it uncomfortable and people have to feel this uncompromising move when you come around, But then also, church, we must understand we have to be consistent in the call that God gives us when making people uncomfortable. Because we can't allow people to draw us in to everything that they're doing. Because they say we are called to be peculiar people. Peculiar in its essence, in its definition, means we are different than everybody else. In the other commentaries, we are set apart. Which simply means when they call you for a drink at 10 o'clock at night, you can't go. Now, can I be real with y'all? I deal with that. Because every now and then, your pastor gets a call. I'm being real with y'all. Y'all ain't got to say amen. Your pastor get a call, and guess what? Your pastor just might go. But there is a character we all must obtain when we go places. Because you never know who you're going to see. Are y'all in here with me? There's a character you have to obtain. And you cannot, even when you try to live the best of your life, cannot put God on a top shelf and take a break from living Christ's life. You have to remain living the way God has called you to live, despite the circumstances and the situations you've been surrounded with. I think that we're not the only witnesses, church, that find living God's purpose is uncomfortable. Abraham was called to take his son Isaac up to Mount Moriah and kill him. He was stuck between good and not so good. Moses on the backside of the mountain was told by a burning bush and an odd voice to go, tell Pharaoh, let my people go. But when he got the people out of Egypt and up to the Red Sea, he asked the Lord, now you got me all the way out here and I don't see nobody. You got me stuck between good and not so good. But God told him, stretch out your rod, and God sent an east wind and they went across dry ground. Joshua went around to the wall of Jericho, and he had to go through Jericho. But because they had wall built so high, they couldn't see over, and wall built so low, they couldn't go under. He said, God, you got me all the way down here, stuck between good and not so good. And God said, just march around seven times, and after the seventh time, give me praise. And I heard the walls came tumbling down. Y'all don't feel me yet? Noah had the ark. He preached it. It's going to rain. It's gonna rain, and people didn't believe him. But God said, keep preaching and keep building, because I'm gonna send the rain. And when God sent the rain, he wanted to tell him, though people didn't like you, and though they didn't look at you, and you were stuck between good and not so good, I can still meet my promises. And I come in here to take courage of saint here. I know it gets hard serving God, and you're stuck between good and not so good. But God told me to tell you that he meets all of his promises. What's the point, church? What's the point in compromising God's purpose? In fact, sometimes we offer up God's purpose as a sacrifice to people who don't even like us. Am I in here today? We offer a sacrifice for people who can't even meet us halfway. And what we turn around and do is make our destination a longer journey, because we put on the line for people who can't even pay our rent. Such is the case for Brother Jonah. Understanding that Jonah's life and legacy is built on this animal character called a dove. Dove in its Greekdom and Hebrew language simply means peace. When Jonah shows up, when you look at Jonah, that is a sign that God brought peace. And not only did God bring peace, but he happens to be the son of Amittai. Somebody shout, son of Amittai. This Amittai word means truth telling. Not only does Jonah show up as Jonah the dove, the peace symbol, but he shows up to tell the truth. Jonah showing up to Nineveh, this wicked city, was an error to let them know that I'm coming to give you peace, and I still love you in spite of all you've done wrong, and I'm going to still bless you in spite of you. But this is the problem, church. Jonah's life is to show up. All he had to do was show up, but Jonah desired not to show up because other people flee to his character. Church, can I tell you that we never know our destiny? As a matter of fact, we're blind to the purpose and destiny on our lives. And when we're blind to the purpose and destiny on our lives, we're just like blind persons searching for some type of aid and help. And if we're not careful, we'll end up running into the wrong direction. And I got to tell you, church, just because your purpose is not attractive, nor is it desirable to those who are around you, you still ought to trust God's word on your life. Here it is, because nobody can direct you better than God can. And I wish I had a witness right there that can give me two of their amens and say, hey, can't nobody do you like God. People, mama and daddy may fail you, your children will disobey you, but when you look to the hills from which cometh your help, you found out that God nor sleep, nor does he slumber, and God is always watching out on your behalf. Jonah has to discover this, church, because in fact, if you learn the historical context of this, Jonah, in fact, hated Nineveh. It was the Ninevites that put his family, his region, in captivity, where they could do nothing but enslave. And it's interesting that God gives his mission to somebody who seeks vengeance. All right. And isn't it something, church, when the mission and purpose God gives you put a brace around your neck? When you are placed in a box, and no matter how much your heart desires to do, God has a way in pulling you back. Can I encourage you to let you know that's when you know you've been born again? When you want to curse somebody out, but God said, hold your tongue. When you know you want to keep they A-double-S, God said, hold your foot. Y'all talk to me in here. When you know you want to turn your back, but God says, lend your helping hand. That's when you know that you've been born. Born again. Seemingly that when this, at this point, God shares to Jonah that your character should not change when you're in the presence of people that held you captive. And that's a word for somebody in here who's allowed their life and what you do in the public or the private change based on the group of people you set yourself around. If God made you uniquely who you are, should nobody in your personal provision change who you are? You are who you are specifically to help somebody else in the places that they're in. And if you stop being who you are to pause to be somebody else, you'll stop them in the productivity that God has on your life. I'm saying that Jonah has to understand your character cannot change. However, church, because Jonah desires vengeance, and listen to me clearly, if you're a person here seeking revenge, you might as well stop. Because if God had already planned it out to be, God will meet the need and he will handle it. I come to this tell you, let it go. I hear that's a word for somebody in here. You've been carrying this for a long time. God says, let it go. Y'all don't hear me, do you? I know they hurt you, turn their back on you, stab you in the back, trip your feet from under you. Let it go. Because what we end up doing, church, we spend most of our lives purpose to knock somebody else down. And we miss out on all the blessing God has in store for our lives. Y'all hear me in here? Jonah's called to go to this place called Nineveh. I'm almost there. Listen. He's called to go deep to this place called Nineveh. And in this time of going to this place called Nineveh, he paid a fare. And this fare was to take him completely opposite of the mission God has for his life. Can I suggest to you that when God gives us mission, he don't put it on the outside of us for people to see it, but he puts it on the inside. Did y'all hear me? People don't know how great of a person you are upon appearance, but they'll find out when they start talking to you. Because what's ever inside gotta come. Y'all talking to me. And so what God is trying to suggest to Jonah, I know you want to go there and vengeance is all on your face, but the mission and purpose is in your heart and in your mind. And I put it there specifically because I can control your heart and mind. If I put it on the outside, you'll be arrogant, but I put it on the inside so I can control you. And this is a word for somebody. Don't neglect what God has put inside of you, because people are not pleading on what's on the outside. They need what's on the inside. And if you don't use what's on the inside, God can never pull his people back into his kingdom. to Thompson Church, the Bible says that a psalm arose. Here it is. The purpose is all in his heart. And when the purpose is in your heart, God can navigate wherever you are.
Amen.
Hear me clear, hear me clearly. There's nowhere you go, God don't know where you are. You can go to the lowest creek. You can go to the nearby bypass. You can go under the overpass between the rock and the little rock and the big rock. God still knows where you are. And here's the shout about it. I got to get to the point. The shout about this is, it's even when we try to hide between the good and the not so good, God has already provided a way to bring us out. And that ought to be somebody shout in here that even when I was stuck in between a rock and a hard place, God still knows where to come and get me and bring me to my preferred destination. God knows how to do it. I wish I had a witness right now. I said, God knows how to do it. And he was in between products under the ship. And they say that the storm was going, and it was going so much so they didn't even know. He didn't even know the storm had arose. And in the process, church, they came up and they started to pull tickets to see, pull lots to see who it was. And obviously, church, it was the man of God. Let me say that again. They began to cast lots. And obviously, out of all the people that were there, it's the person that stood out. Try that again. And it was time to figure out who did wrong. The person that stood out was the man of God. And seemingly that's what it looks like, church, because we always battle between the good and the not so good, and compromising with what God told us to do. We find ourselves always being the eyeball and being the reason why we're in the mess that we're in. When you run from purpose and you find yourself stuck between a rock and a hard place, or the good and the not so good, sometimes it's not God doing it, it's yours. And the moment, church, we find out that we are the reason why we are where we are, is the quicker we will get to where we're trying to be. That maybe, church, the reason why we can't love the people like we want to love them, because we got hatred in our heart. Because we want to give. We can't give to people that like we want to. And we can't raise the money like we want to, because everybody got their own personal agenda. The reason why we find ourselves casting lots is not because it's God's destiny, it's because it's our own preferred destination. Cast lots. And they cast lots. Watch what happened. He got picked and they threw him overboard. Now, Jonah, church, I want to tell you, Jonah is trying by all means to kill himself. This is a word, capture me. He's trying to kill himself, so he asked him to throw me overboard, thinking that he would drown and God's purpose on his life would not find him. But here it is. I told you that the purpose not on the outside. The purpose is on the inside. And Jonah is not the ruler and controller of his heartbeat. If God continues to allow the heart to beat and the mind to think, then God can still move you up to where you should be. I simply come to tell you, not only should you let go, but you can't stop here. I know you're depressed and I know you tried every end, but maybe you need to try another, because you can't stop here. And if God allows you every day to wake up, I don't care what the circumstances is, that's God divinely telling you that I'm giving you another shot at this. I'm cracking open the skies and shining the light on your face to let you know you ought to try it again, baby. I know you came in here discouraged. I know your head was held down, but stick your chest out and hold your head up high, because I got something for you, baby. If you keep walking, turn that corner. I got something for you. Come on, help me preach. Shake to your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor, he got some for you. Yeah. Yeah. He got something for you. Hold me a little while, Holy Ghost. Verse 15. Verse 15. Oh, Jesus. Go and get your deliverance. That's it right there. That's all right. That's all right. That's what somebody needed right there. And you ought to go and get your deliverance. And I dare you to reach up and grab it. God got something for you. And I know you don't see it right now. But God can make a way out of no way. If God can create the side sky and the sea, God can make a way. If God can take a voided planet, turn light on, call it the earth, he can make a way. If God can take the ground, dust, make a mountain, he can make a way. If God can take his son, send him down to the pits of earth, he can make a way. And then if he can get his own cross and take it up to his own mountain and die by his sins, and hold on, get up 3 days later, he can make a way. Yes, Lord. Sit down, sit down. I got some more preaching in. Yeah. I'm there now. I'm there now. Then they took Jonah to him overboard. And the problem for them stopped. And in Jonah church, there's a possibility. Hear me well. And I'm about to reverse your mind mentality. There's a possibility to have joy in depression. And you spend more time giving up. You put joy in depression. But the Lord provided a great fish and swallowed Jonah. And Jonah was inside the fish 3 days, 3 nights. Almost 2,000 years later from this text, Christ would use this situation to be how he would show the people the miracle that he was going to do through salvation. Y'all missed it. Some almost 2,000 years, hear me well, later, he would use this same situation to show a sign for people on how he was going to deal with salvation. Y'all didn't hear me. This same situation, y'all hear me? He was going to use it. That he was going to use this to show the people 2,000 years later, this is how I'm going to save your life. Can I suggest to you, church, that purpose is not predicated on our presence? That God can still use circumstances to get his point across? And that if you don't be careful, church, God can use somebody else to get his purpose across to the nations? And this is a word I want to encourage somebody with. You be careful, because the church don't need you. Almost there. Y'all stick with me. 2 more minutes. Because the reality is, if you keep making it hard for God to get where he's going to go, I'm trying to tell you, God can put an early date on your dying day. And let me tell you what's going to happen. The church not going to stop. We're going to come in here on Saturday. We're going to come in here. I'm going to preach over your body. We're going to go to the cemetery. I'm going to say, ash to ash, dust to dust, commit this body to the heaven who created it. And we're going to go back to the fellowship hall. Y'all know our menu. Fried chicken, apples, green beans. Yeah. Peach cobbler, sweet tea, and water. And we're going to come back in here the next day to say, this is the day that the Lord has made. And we shall rejoice and be glad in it. I come to that and tell you, if you ain't gonna act right, God gonna make it act right. But we have a merciful God. Because what the text says is that God, Brother Lewis, will not seek vengeance on you. But our God's so loving, it make me happy. Because the text says he'll provide. He'll provide. Say that again. I said he'll provide for you. And let me free somebody, because obviously this is a service, a deliverance, because so many of you have done wrong by your own self, done bad all by yourself, and you feel as if nobody loves you and people have wrote you off. But I come today to tell you that God still got his eye on you, and God will still provide for you what you need when you're stuck in good and not so good. God, I'm almost there, y'all. God not only will provide something for you. I wish y'all see this adjective here. The Bible says he didn't just provide a fish. Oh, I wish y'all read y'all Bible. The Bible says he didn't provide just a fish. The Bible says, verse 17, but the Lord provided a great. God, when you in trouble, church, don't just provide something for you, but God lets your problem know. Problem, I'm bigger than you. And problem, since you tried to take my purpose down, I gotta let my purpose step on top of you. And I come today to tell somebody, lean on Jesus Christ to provide for you what others can't provide. Oh, somebody can deliver right now. I see your faces right now. God don't provide small gifts. Y'all hear what I said? Let me tell you why. Because the greater your problem, the greater God has to become. Because God won't allow your problem to outdo him. And that ought to be your encouragement when you walk out of here. I know you've been trying to figure it out. But I come today to tell you God has already worked it out. I ain't done it in a minute, church, so I got to do it for myself. Because I tried Jesus for myself. And I found out that God can do anything but faith. I tried Jesus for myself. And I found out that God can pick you up when you fall. Won't he do it? God will help you when you fall. Anybody here that knows God will turn things around for you, good or bad, God use it for your good. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor, be not dismayed. Whatever be the time, God will take care of you. You have no sleep at night, but tonight you have peace because you got purpose. Because when you got a purpose, you got God's presence. Is there anybody here to say, I got purpose on my life? Because I got purpose, I got peace, because I got God's presence. How do you know that, Pastor? Well, he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me that I am his own, and his own, and the joy that we share as we tarry, there. None of us should ever know. Y'all got that joy today. The Bible says that the redeemed of the Lord say so. You ought to stand to your feet, shake somebody's hand, and say, neighbor, God has been good to me, and I come all the way to 135 Luke to tell somebody, if it had not been for the Lord of my side, I don't know where I would be. Is there anybody here that gonna give a praise? Because when praise go up, blessings come down. And when blessings come down, praise go up. On the count of three, you get the best praise that you got. One, two, three. Yes! Won't do it. I
Amen. doors of the church is open. May you come out loud. May you come out Christian in spirit. Amen. God is still in control. He's still working while your legs sleep slumber. Or baptism, you can come. Amen. He's still in control, y'all. The doors of the church is now open.
Sitting down, which the person sitting down are the persons need the blessings and the deliverance. Don't let the spirit get too high when you miss it. If you a person that need deliverance, you ought to be standing on your feet right now. If you need God to move in your life, you ought to be standing right now. And listen, if you don't know Jesus and the pardon of your sin, you need to be at this altar right now. You lost your way and need redirection, you ought to come. If you don't have a church home to call home, a person to preach to your soul and guide you, you ought to come right now. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Don't miss out. Don't keep coming and missing out. I don't care who's looking at you. Don't miss out. They don't go home and cry to sleep like you do. They don't get paycheck to paycheck trying to pay off ends meet like you do. Come now. in the name of Jesus, it's already done. It's already done. You set free because you came. You are healed because you came. You're delivered because you came. You took the first step. God is going to take 10 right now in the name of Jesus. Financial dependence and independence right now in the name of Jesus. Because you came to his house, he's coming to your house in the name of Jesus. Your children going to be all right because you came in the name of Jesus. Your family's going to be all right because you came in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Right now, I ask that you, God, give them peace in their mind. God, I don't know what they deal with when they go to sleep at night, but God, I ask that you comfort them right now. God, I know they probably feel lonely right now, but God, I ask that you touch them right now. God, they're looking for you to touch right now, so God, come through me right now. Use me as a willing instrument to touch their lives right now. God, make a difference this day as they go back home. God, they see things differently now. God, give them enough perspective right now on life, on family, on their realities, God. God, give them a burning desire to serve you and give to you earnestly in the name of Jesus. God, they've been looking and searching and caught nothing, but God, I ask that you redirect them right now in the name of Jesus. God, make it make sense. God, make all of it make sense right now. God, not allow them to blame themselves for what they've gone through or what they've done, God. But let them know, God, you are able to provide great things in their life right now in the name of Jesus. So, God, not allow them to forgive somebody else, but allow them to forgive themselves right now in the name of Jesus. And, God, allow them to be well with their souls, God. Feel love back into their hearts, God. Patience back in their mind. Perseverance, God. Give them a burning desire to seek you in the name of Jesus. Put you first and all other things shall be added. God, and I ask that you bless these children right now. Bless their minds, God. Bless their parents, God. Give them wisdom right now like you gave Solomon. Give them strength like you gave David. In the name of Jesus.
Bless them right now in the name of Jesus.
Touch them right now. Let them look past disappointment. Let them look past their hurts. Let them know that God is still able. God is still able. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Be delivered, be set free. Don't let nobody stop you from your deliverance. That's all right. That's all right. That is all right. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And for those of you coming up here on somebody else's behalf, because you had faith to jump for somebody else, God is going to make a bigger leap for you. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. You got many more mountains to go, and God needs you to be strong. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
I worship and adore.
Thank you, God.
Thank you,
Lord. Just want to thank you.
Tell you.
Every tear that's crying right now, be lifting them right now with his name. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Peace, God. Peace. Peace. In the name of Jesus. Peace in the name of Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you.
Just want to tell you.
Well, she don't even want to stay. In the name of Jesus.
God. Give anointing power. Give set free power, God. Delivery power, God. Give the feet to run when you don't feel like running. Give the toes to stand when you don't feel like standing. In the name of Jesus, touch his body right now. And give him strength, God. Continue to bless him with you. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Careful to give your name glory, honor, and praise. This I ask of Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Come on, y'all, clap your hands if you believe it. God has set you free. Come on, clap your hands. I can't hear nobody. Y'all ought to act like God has done so for you. Don't wait till the battle is over. Go ahead and shout it out now. Come on, y'all. Y'all ought to stand to your feet. Tell the Lord, thank you for healing me, God. Thank you for setting me free in my marriage. God, thank you for setting me free in my finances. God, thank you for making a way even though I don't see it. God, thank you for bringing my children back home. God, thank you. Hallelujah. An announcement the homecoming committee needs to make. I need you all to pay attention real closely. Hello, somebody. Yes, sir, the spirit is hot. But I just want to, they drew me in on this committee. These are the t-shirts that, because we didn't have a t-shirt last year. So we decided to do one this year, and it's indicating 151 years. I don't know another church been around 151 years. So this is something to celebrate. And as I was looking back over the history of St. Luke, we're not celebrating for us. We're celebrating for those that came before us. And the ones that's going to come after us will be celebrating for us. And we want to try to keep 150 years going. So this is the t-shirt, and it's only $10. And if you need a 3X or 4X, it's $14.
What about
6X? 6X, maybe. We know you're gonna make it good to us, Big Mike. So we want everybody, first of all, we want to try to get that done. And we're gonna have a good time with this homecoming, I promise you. We're gonna do a barbecue cook-off, and baby, I got it sizzling right now. I got it sizzling, baby. I got the wood smoking. But we're going to have a good time, and we want everybody to celebrate and be a part. So like I said, we're not doing it for us. We're doing it for the ones that come before us, that paved the way before us. So this is a sample shirt. We're going to order them tomorrow, and hopefully, you know, everybody purchase one. All right. We were supposed to have a model to model this T-shirt, but I don't know what happened.
I just want to say that this is a large, but I just wanted to say please, everyone, please purchase a t-shirt. It's been a while since we had a t-shirt. I remember when I first joined St. Luke in 2007, every time you looked up, it was a t-shirt. And I know I probably purchased all of those t-shirts. So I'm not saying that this is a new St. Luke. This is the same St. Luke. But this, now we're under the leadership of Pastor Nicholas Patterson. So let's do the same thing that we did when Pastor Stevenson was here, because you all bought shirts, bought shirts, and bought shirts. So let's buy this shirt, okay? And also, I want you all to know that John Grayson is the best griller in South Nashville.
The Bible does say there will be division among us. Well, you know what? Either way it goes, food is food. And nobody, y'all can make a competition. I just want to come to eat. I don't care who look good cooking. They're going to be sweating anyway. I'm going to look cute. Amen. Listen, yes, please, please pay attention to those announcements. Y'all, please support this. We're not doing it for us. We're doing it for all of us. Together we stand. Divided we what? We fall. Amen. Again, I told y'all I have tickets for the car wash. Tickets for the car wash. My hand's going to be on these cards. Amen. See, if you want your car blessed, touched, and anointed, and all that good stuff with the soap, I'm going to pray over the soap. And I'm going to roll, scrub, dub, and all that good stuff for you. Amen. And then listen, I have this list, school supply list for Napier Elementary. We're trying to bless the children at Napier and in this community. And I want you all to come get this in the vestibule and bless these children. Now, also with that, if you don't feel like going to the store and buying school supplies, you also can give amount of money, $20, $30, $40, $50, maybe $100, whatever God put on your heart to give. But I want y'all to give to this thing so we can bless these children in this community. Amen. Amen. I believe, where is Ms. Burke? Are we taking names for children today? Yes? I'm going to let her speak to you.
We have any children that would like to sign up to the backpack we see my daughter today. We'll be doing it for 2 weeks.
So Sierra, raise your hand one more time so they can see you. Backpack school supplies, amen. Backpack school supplies. I let the youth know we're going to bless the community, but we're going to bless our children first. Amen. So if your children is in need, please see them at the church. If I have reached out to you, individually handpicked you for some outreach adventures, I need you over in the fellowship hall, a brief moment. And also a reminder, this is off St. Luke's account. Deacon Eugene Caldwell, who was an ordained deacon in this church, is having a benefit program at Friendship Church on Buena Vista Pike. He had got diagnosed with cancer, and he is in his fourth stage. Amen. And we want to go be a support to him as much as possible, all those who can and will. That begins at 2:30. Amen. Amen, somebody. If you can't, send your presence, send your prayers. Amen. All right, y'all ready to go? Y'all shouted up a storm good enough? You want another shout? My musicians don't mind doing it. I mean, hey, amen. Let's all stand. Let's all stand. Bow your heads. Eternal God, we thank you. We praise you. I ask that, God, you touch every soul right now. I ask that you, God, put the blood over their lives as they leave this place. Never from your watchful sight. Cover them, God. Anything sick, healed, anything broken, mended, anything confused, delivered. This I ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.